Getting footage from a drone or a UAV can add just that tiny little bit more of a unique element to anything that you're really doing, whether that's photography or videography or film or whatever it is that's actually taking place. You can really add something to that visual by using a UAV or a drone. What's happening, guys? Dan Debenham here. We're talking about drone footage and the footage that you collect from a UAV, whether that's photography or videography. More specifically, in this case, it's the video side of things, and it's adding just like an element to it, to that footage, that just gives it a little bit of atmosphere or a little bit of uniqueness to it. And we all know, fantastic weather, clear day, etc., etc., they can deliver some fantastic footage. You get some great video or some great photography from a beautiful clear day. But adding a little bit of atmosphere like this to a video can actually give a sense of what the area is like. So it can set up your shot your ground shots to be more in tune with what you've shot from your UAV. And in this tutorial, I'm going to show you how we add in elements, in this case cloud cover, to a UAV shot that was only shot at about 120 feet. So we're not talking at the really, really top high-end barrier of how high you can fly a UAV. We're talking only 100 knot feet. 400 is the sort of upper limit here in the UK, without going and speaking to CAA and getting signed off and all the rest of it. So with that, let's dive into After Effects and let's have a look and see how we go about doing it. It's pretty simple. Okay, so we're now in After Effects, and what we want to do is we want to create a composition from our footage. So I've got some drone footage here. We're just going to create a comp from that, which is great. And we're going to scroll across to a bit of the footage that we actually want. So where are we going to go? So I reckon maybe from there. So let's junk all the footage but that bit at the beginning.
Yeah.
Go. Okay. So we're going to start there. And then our footage is going to stop. Probably at this road. So let's just stop it at that road. And let's just trim the comp to the work area. Because what we don't want to be doing is we don't want to be messing with any more footage visual effects wise than we need to. So in essence, if you're doing this directly from Premiere Pro, chop out the bit that you want and then replace it with an After Effects composition that fetches you in here with just the bit that you need to actually put the visual effects on. There's no point in trying to do all this for the entire project, because it's just going to crash your computer, or it's going to suck out all the power, or it's going to take hours and hours and hours. You just want to do the little bits that you need to put those visual effects on. And then once you've done it, come out of it. If you need to put another visual effect on, go back in, do something else with it. So you're building on top of video rather than building layer upon layer upon layer upon layer upon layer, which in essence will just slow down After Effects anyway, because it's trying to calculate all the stuff that's already happened along with all the stuff that needs to happen, etc., etc. So with this, what we're going to do now is we're going to come over to our effects and presets panel, and we're going to type in 3D camera tracker, and we're going to drag that, and we're going to drop it onto our layer, so that we've got our project and composition all doing what it needs to do. So it's now analyzing in the background, and that's step one of two, obviously, as it nicely tells you. And what it's going to do there is it's going to give us a million different points that we can use to give us some 3D data in order for us to be able to track the visual effect that we're going to add on in a moment. So I'll come back to you in a minute when that has done what it's supposed to do. I think it's got a minute left to work on it. It's 20% of the way through now anyway. So I'll see you guys any second. Right, so camera tracker, 3D camera tracker has done its business all over this picture, all over this footage, and it's given us a million of these different little coloured icons splotted all over the footage itself. Now these are going to help us, because what these are going to do is these are going to allow us to put a marker point in that allows our visual effect to track at what point in the video it needs to be moving. So now we've got to do is go along and we see all these discs, and each one is on a different plane, and as you can see we just fly through them all like so, and they're all the way out, right back out here. Some of them are up here. And it's done a great job of tracking stuff, but we need to pick one that we think is going to match what angle we want our video, our visual effect to take. So we need to find one that sort of matches where we are. And that's that one. Where was that one? That one's not bad. That one's not bad. It's sort of on the same plane as where we were. As where we are with our camera, so we're sort of, that disc is moving along the top of those houses, so around that car park bit there, car park, it's a graveyard. How awkward. Okay, so let's have another look and see if we've got any more. That one's a bit off to the left. It's a little bit off. That's even more off to the left. Have we got any more over this side that might fit? Maybe that one. That's not a bad one either. I think I'm going to try this one. I'm going to try that one. So we're going to click on it. You get three little dots. That triangle, that's the point in which it's going to try and track you to. And we're going to right click on it, and then we're going to go create null and camera. Okay, so we've created null and camera. We can click off that now. We don't need any of those because we've got that down here in this system here. So the next thing we want to do is we want to go back to our project, pick our cloud. So for me, I'm using a PNG. And the reason I'm using a PNG is because it's transparent at the background. So there's nothing behind it. So this is just a static image of a cloud taken from like Google or whatever. And we're going to drop that on. So this is a PNG. So I'm going to drag that and drop it on. And then I'm going to quickly just sort of resize this image to sort of roughly the size I want it to be. I'm holding shift down to constrain the proportions as well, so that we know that it's going to be the right shape, it's not squished, which is cool. Okay, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to come down here to our project bin where all our stuff is. And I'm going to hit the little square cube there, which makes this layer, this cloud layer, 3D. And then when I click on it, I get these handles up and such. So I can tilt, turn, twist, move, etc., etc., etc. Now, one thing I do want to do is I want to drop this cloud down. And the reason I'm doing that is because in my instance, there's a bit of cloud up here that is going to encroach on this overcast sky. And I don't want this cloud to be in the actual sky itself. I want it to be in the foreground. So I'm going to stick it there like so. And then what I'm going to do is, once we've done that, I'm going to come back over to our effects and presets panel. And I'm going to type in turbulent. Or turb, as I have done. And I'm going to get turbulent displace. And then I'm going to drag and I'm going to drop that onto the cloud. So that's now got turbulent displacement on it. Now what that's going to do is it's going to give a tiny, tiny, tiny bit of movement to the cloud in itself. So it's going to move it ever so slightly. It's not like something that you're going to need to make it do massive swirls, but it's going to need to do something. So we're going to go to evolution. We're going to click the stopwatch, which gives us a keyframe, and we're going to leave it at zero. And then I'm going to come to around about halfway. And we can see the clouds moved already. And then I'm going to type in 90. And you saw it move there. And then I'm going to come full way here. And we're going to type in 180. And this is entirely a personal preference. This is entirely up to you how you want that to work. And it's in essence, when I if I come off this and click off of it now, and we go to fit this to screen so you can see where things are. You can see the tracking point where we're using. That won't be on the final video, obviously. But what we can do is we can scrub through, and as you can see, the clouds move backwards with the forward motion of the UAV. But it gives the appearance that we are slightly higher, or the cloud is low. It's got low cloud or fog, and we can then move in back into Premiere Pro, and we can color correct it so that it looks something like. If you want to color correct it yourself, we can do it from within After Effects. You can type in Lumatri, and it'll come up with Lumatri color, and then we can just bring this down to the DJI footage, and here we can do a basic color correction. So we can say, right, okay, let's take the highlights down on this. So we can pull the highlights down, we can pull the whites down slightly, like so, to give it that little bit more. We can fetch the shadows in, so there's a little bit of darkness there. And what we can also do is we can probably bring the exposure maybe down by point -0.2, like so, just to give it a little bit of darkness, just to darken it off a little bit. Then what we can do is we can go to saturation, and we can desaturate that, and then we can check from there whether or not it needs to be re-exposed. So we'll go 0.5, which brings the exposure up a bit, which makes it a little bit more stark, and we'll fetch the contrast up a little bit. And then in creative, what we can do now is we can either bring in a little bit of fade, so that is at zero. So if we fetched in maybe a 30% fade on that film there, and we took the vibrance of stuff down slightly, then effectively what we've done there is we have just adjusted the colors a little bit, so that this whole thing sort of has a darker feel to it rather than it being sunny. Because when this shot was took, even though it was slightly overcast, the sun was pretty strong on that particular day. So what we've done is taken the sun out a little bit. If we wanted to, we could obviously tint that a little bit, so we could change the temperature. So we could nip in a little bit of blue, just to take out some of the sun, so it's still bright, but we've got a much flatter picture now. It's much colder than it was before, and obviously we can start messing around with the sky and that kind of stuff further down the line when your project's finished. But in this case, what we've actually got is we've got this video with some sky, and we've got some cloud in here, and you can see the cloud is moving ever so slightly. It's just making a move on its own, as well as moving back out of shot and out of frame, and that just gives it a tiny bit more atmosphere and a tiny bit more realism if you wanted to shoot on an overcast day, which in the UK is quite often. But it just ties the two things together and shows you can add an element to aerial footage to give it some sort of cinematic look. Such a great way of marrying the two bits of footage together and getting your sort of ground level footage to work with your aerial footage and vice versa, so that they sort of marry and they match, and the viewer looks like they get that, evoke that feeling, and that they're both the same place almost, and that it sort of relate to one another. And it just is that next step on from just, got some great aerial footage, now what am I going to do with it? And it's making that aerial footage, that great aerial footage that you've shot, It's making that fit with the rest of your project. And if that calls for a bit of cloud, now you know how you can put that bit of cloud in, and you can make that footage sort of match up and be part of that story rather than just some great, and it probably is, great aerial footage. It just wants that little bit extra. You need to sometimes go that little bit further to sort of get the viewer to understand what's happening from a ground level with your aerial footage, and vice versa with you've shot on the ground and now you need some aerial footage. It's got to match, and it's got to be it's got to all look like it's from the same place and the same thing. So with that, I hope you did find that useful, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.